one more time. You, we thank you, Lord. We know, Lord, you don't leave us in the storm, Lord. You take us through it. Hallelujah. Lord, you take us through the valleys and you get us on the mountain and you take us through whatever we need to go through, Lord God, because you don't leave us, Lord. You don't leave us and you don't forsake us. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord, that you are a God that I can trust, that you are a God that I can rely on. Hallelujah. I worship you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that your eyes are upon the righteous and your ears are open to the cry of the righteous. Hallelujah. We are the righteous of God, and his eyes are upon us and his ears are open to our cry. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We're going to just praise him tonight. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. blessing and honor.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days.
Every tongue.
Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God. And your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days.
Your kingdom. From beginning to the end, you're the Alpha and the Omega, from everlasting to everlasting. Hallelujah. Lord, we worship you. Of your kingdom, there shall be no end. No end to your kingdom, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, you are a victorious champion. Hallelujah. You have defeated death, hell, and the grave. Hallelujah. And you rule and reign. You rule and reign over all things. Hallelujah. You rule and reign over us, Lord. You rule and reign over us. We are your kings, hallelujah, and your priests, Lord God. We are your servants, Lord God, and we worship you tonight. We bless you and praise you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Will be stripped away.
Bye-bye.
Praise your name. Praise you. Bless you, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you for your presence here and wherever people are watching. I thank you, Father, that you meet needs, no matter what they are. I thank you, Father, that your power is healing power, among many other things. I thank you, Father, that you do everything you can to work restoration in our lives and in our relationships. Father, I just say, may our knees be bowed to the fullness of your will, that your will would be fully accomplished in our lives. Thank you again for tonight, Father. And by the time this service is over, I pray that everyone here, everyone watching, will truly have had a tremendous experience with you. Jesus, thank you again for being our Savior. We enjoy worshiping you. In your name, Jesus, amen. Amen. Praise God. All right. Shake a hand. Hug a neck. Those of you, same thing. If you're there alone by yourself, well, just shake your own hand. Hallelujah. Good evening, and thank you for coming back tonight. Greatly appreciate it. You know, you look around at everybody, and you know, and you shake hands and so forth. I find it interesting how every now and then somebody will post a picture from back when somebody in the family got married or when they got married. And you look at that and you think, wow, I'm sure glad I haven't changed that much. Then I see a picture of me from years ago, and I think, man, oh, this is not good. But, it happens slowly. One little wrinkle at a time, day by day. Yeah, one gray hair at a time. Then there you are, older than you ever thought you'd be, wondering how you got there, but glad you're still around. Praise God. Don't forget that Wednesday night, July 4th, no service, because it is the 4th of July. So, it'll be a good time for parties, and the Pages are, again, inviting everybody down to their house for food, fun, fireworks, and fellowship. So if you need directions on how to get there and more information about, well, what time, what do I bring, just make sure you see one of the members of the Page household. They'll give you all the information you need. Praise God. Tonight I want to share some things about revival. I know I've taught on revival before, but in this message tonight, it really is going to be important that you pay attention, because if you don't listen closely, you might think that I am refuting some things I've taught in the past about revival. But I am not. I'm not refuting, I'm adding to. And this is going to bring some clarity, because one of the things that churches who are believing for revival can go through is, gee whiz, God, when? When? We've been praying and we've been confessing for revival for however many years. And it sure would be nice to see it. Well, God's the same way. I mean, he'd like to see it too. But he doesn't just do it. He doesn't choose one city over another. He doesn't choose one generation over another. He waits for people to do what they're supposed to. And then it happens. Now, we're going to start in Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. And again, I am not refuting anything that I've taught in the past. I'm not refuting what you may have heard others teach in the past. Of course, I might be refuting what some people somewhere have preached. You'll understand as we go further into this. In Mark chapter 16, now, what we're going to be reading are verses, not just here in Mark, but other places, that verses that are specific to when Jesus rose from the dead. Not prior to his crucifixion, but after the crucifixion and resurrection. And that includes here Mark 16. Jesus is meeting with the apostles, and he says, "Go ye into all the world," verse 15, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Now that's just a part of what he said after his resurrection. Let's go to Matthew 28 and see a little bit more. Matthew 28, and again, this is after he has raised from the dead. In Matthew 28, beginning in verse 18, "And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Well, let's read a little bit more of what he said. Turn to Luke. No, I tell you what, turn to John. We'll go to Luke in a moment. John 21. Now in John 21, what we're getting ready to read, again, after the resurrection, Jesus had appeared to the apostles and they all sat down and had a fish dinner. Well, we pick it up in verse 15. "So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved, because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep." Now turn over to Luke. Luke chapter 24. And as far as, well, to keep this short, we'll just go to verse 49. Jesus said, "And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high." Now turn to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Beginning in verse 4. "And being assembled together with them, Jesus commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he saith unto him, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And it says in verse 9, when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. Now we're not going to go back and reread any of this, but think closely about what you just heard. Think closely about the instructions that Jesus gave them, what they were supposed to do. Now in Acts chapter 2, we know the story. This is the day of Pentecost. Cloven tongues like as of fire, rushing mighty wind. They can feel the Holy Ghost. They begin to speak in tongues. Peter stands up and he preaches. We pick it up in verse 41. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. Then in chapter 3, we see the man that was lame is healed. Silver and gold have I none, you know, rise and walk and all that. Then Peter preaches again and he says, look, this is not our power, you know, this is God, the name of Jesus. All right, that's how this happened. Well, the religious leaders got all mad, grabbed them, arrested them, threw them in jail. But in chapter 4, verse 4, it says, howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. So we see thousands of people coming to know Jesus. And this is happening within an extremely short period of time. So we would look at this and think, look at there, see, revival. Well, that's true. That's true, revival. But now look back over in Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. Because there's more to this story than what we read the first time here in Mark. In Mark 16, verse 15, Jesus said to them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned, and these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. Now you notice the word them is in italics. Well, it's not supposed to be there. It's supposed to read like this. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with and confirming the word with signs following. Now here's what's interesting. In everything that we've read post resurrection, everything in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where Jesus gave instructions to the apostles, told them what to do. And it wasn't just the apostles, it was others, because we know that there were about 120 people there in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. Jesus never told them, go start revival. He never told them, pray for revival. He never told them, confess for revival. What he did tell them to do was this: be witnesses unto him, go and preach, baptize the converts, teach the converts, and do his works. That's what he told them to do. To follow that up, when you begin in Acts, well, you can start in Acts chapter 1 if you want, but really Acts chapter 2, and just start reading through the New Testament, you're not going to find where the apostles gave an instruction. Now that you're in the kingdom, pray for revival. They never said, confess for revival. They never said, go somewhere and start revival. Now, at this point, somebody could say, well, wait a second, hold on. Are you now saying that we're not supposed to pray for revival? I'm not saying that. Well, are you saying that we shouldn't confess for revival? I'm not saying that either. What I'm saying is, what do we see in Scripture? What's the instruction? Now, there's a point to this. We focus so much, not every single Christian maybe, but for the people that want revival, we focus so much on we need to have revival, we need to pray for revival, we need to confess for revival, that we miss something else that in a different way is more important. You say, well, what could be more important than people getting saved? I didn't say something more important than people getting saved. You'll understand here. We have a lot of people who are praying and confessing for a revival, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's a thing to do. That's all right. It's perfectly all right. However, I want you to notice what happened here. You know, in the book of Acts, there again in chapter 2, where all these people hear Peter preach. See, Jesus didn't say, go to Jerusalem, tarry till you be endued with power, and then start revival. He didn't say that. He just said, you'll receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you'll be witnesses unto me. So then what happened? Well, the day of Pentecost, rushing mighty wind, cloven tongues like as of fire, filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues. Some people mock, some people, what is this? Peter stands up and says, let me tell you what's going on. He tells them what's going on. Thousands of people get saved. They did not go to Jerusalem to start revival. They went to Jerusalem to be endued with power. Do you understand this? He didn't say, go ye to Jerusalem, tarry in Jerusalem, and start revival. Pray in revival. Now we know they prayed, but they didn't have that instruction. The truth of the matter is, all they knew was, okay, he said, go there, wait, be filled with the Holy Ghost. I guess we'll know what to do after that. And so that's what they did. He didn't say, go there and have prayer meetings, confession services to have revival. Just wait till you're filled with the Holy Ghost and power. I said, okay. Well, they get filled with the Holy Ghost and power. Peter stands up on the day of Pentecost, preaches that sermon, thousands of people get saved. They did not know that was going to happen. They did not know that was in God's divine plan. They didn't know that would be the outcome. Now listen to this. All they knew to do was wait on God and be filled with the Holy Ghost and receive power. That was all they knew. That was it. And they did, and then all these people get saved. Well, in chapter 2, it says in verse 41, then they that gladly received his word were baptized the same day, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And the apostles gathered them together and said, we must confess and pray for more souls. We must confess and pray for revival to sweep throughout all of Galilee. No, it doesn't say that. What does it say? They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship, breaking bread, and in prayers. And then it says down in verse 46 that they continuing daily with one accord in the temple. In other words, these people weren't gathering together for the purpose of praying in revival. All they knew was they just got saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. Now what do we do? And the apostle said, all right, well, listen, everybody, let's all get together, and we will do what Jesus told us to do. What did Jesus tell them to do? Declare the word. Those who believe will be baptized, baptize them, and then do what? Teach them to observe everything I've taught you. They are being obedient to the Lord. You see this? Now, what do you think it was that they were teaching the people, you know, daily in the temple and, you know, steadfastly the apostles' doctrine? Well, they were teaching the people what Jesus had taught them. And right before, you can go back and read about this over, like in Luke and all. But one of the other things he did was put them in remembrance of the things that he had taught them. So now, the apostles are just doing what he told them to do. Declare the word. People that believe are baptized. Then they're teaching the people. That was it. They were not trying to start revival. Because see, when we talk about revival, we're talking about the power of God sweeping through the city, and we call Dayton saved, we call the Miami Valley saved, and all that. And that's not wrong. It's not at all wrong. But we're not told to seek for revival. Do you understand what I'm getting at? We don't have an instruction, now that you're saved, seek for revival to sweep your city. Again, I'm not saying it's wrong to pray for revival, and I'm not saying it's wrong to confess for revival. But there's something else that God is after as far as we are concerned, meaning believers. And I want to show you what that is. Well, it's kind of a summary, but look over in Ephesians chapter 1. Now remember, when we read these things in Scripture, this is God speaking through, you know, in this case, you know, the Apostle Paul. But this is God speaking through his servant to get across to us what he wants to see happen in us. So here in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints. Okay, verse 15, you know, simply put, after I heard that you've been born again and, you know, you've got faith in the Lord, so on and so forth. Well, I ceased not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. What we have just read is what God wants for us. This is what he wants in our lives. And there is no instruction in here, pray for or confess for a revival. And again, I'm not saying it's wrong to do that. What I'm saying is, there's something God wants to see take place in our lives. Now look over in Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 14. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Are you seeing this? This is something else that God is saying, I want this to happen in your life. There's nothing in here about revival. This is all about us as individual believers. He's saying, I want this to be you. I want you to develop into everything I'm saying here. Now look over in Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, verse 9. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. Here's another revelation of what God wants to see take place in our lives. And again, this is not about revival. This is about us as believers. Now, one other place. Turn to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. For this cause, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to His glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Now, once again, what we're seeing here is an instruction from God. This is what I want to see take place in your life. This is what I want to see happen. Now, if you read Romans all the way through to the book of Revelation, you're not going to see an instruction from God to the body of Christ, go start revival. You're not going to see an instruction from God, go pray for revival. You're not going to see an instruction from God, confess for revival. Again, those things aren't wrong. But what we do see is God saying, I want you to do what the apostles did, even if you're not called to be an apostle. Meaning, we declare the word. We see people that are saved, we get them baptized. Now, granted, not everybody in the church does that, but I'm talking as the body of Christ. We disciple them. We teach them. And then we do the works of Jesus. Lay hands on the sick. Cast out devils. All these kinds of things. But along with that, we need to do what we just read here in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. Meaning, if we're not doing what we've read, what God desires for us, that we've just discovered in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, if we are putting on the blinders and ignoring that, and then all we do is sit around and confess for revival, I want revival. You know, I want to see revival take place. In the name of Jesus, I call the Miami Valley in revival, or wherever you live. Father, we declare we are in revival. Those things aren't wrong. But if we're doing that and ignoring the clear instruction from God, we are not following in the footsteps of the apostles. Because when the apostles did what they did, it wasn't for the purpose of, fellas, listen, now, we're going to have to decide where each one of us is going to go and start revival. That wasn't it. It was, okay, where does God want us to go to do what Jesus said to do? And if five people responded, If 5,000 responded, 5,000 responded. All they knew was, go out there, declare salvation through Jesus. The people that get born again, get them filled with the Holy Ghost, baptize them in water, and then teach them. And in the meantime, cast out devils, raise the dead, heal the sick, the maimed get whole. Do you see what I'm getting at? But it wasn't about focus on revival. It was focus on becoming what God has said to become. Now, I want you to see something. Turn to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. Now, see, the one thing that we cannot deny is that when the apostles went places, yeah, there was an outbreak of salvations. People got saved. In some places, you know, well, we see the thousands getting saved in Jerusalem. We see that Philip went and he ministered in this whole particular city in Samaria. You know, it says that everybody gets saved and so forth. And we call that revival. And it's okay to call that revival. However, I want you to see something here. It has to do with the life of Paul. Because in our minds, it's almost like we have developed this image that Peter and James and John and Matthew and a bunch of them, including Paul, went someplace to start revival, to have revival. That was not the case. They went someplace to be obedient to the instructions of Jesus, and if revival happened, it happened. Do you understand this? See, this is why I said earlier, it can sound like I'm teaching something contradictory to what I've taught in the past or what other people have taught. I'm not doing that. I'm not teaching it. What I'm saying is there's been so much emphasis in so many churches and so forth about revival, 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 and that's not wrong, but there's so much more to this. That wasn't the focus of the apostles. The focus of the apostles was, okay, Jesus has told us to do these things right here. All right, let's go do them. Let's just do them. The day of Pentecost. Man, they didn't know thousands of people were going to get saved. That, in fact, that was probably a shock to them. Look at this. It's the day of Pentecost. All these Jews are accepting Jesus. Look at this. We get the gift of the Holy Ghost. Boy, oh boy, we're going to be doing a whole lot of baptizing. Because Jesus said to baptize them. That's what they did. And then he said, teach them what I've taught you. So he said, all right, now folks, listen, we need to get together. We're going to be in the temple every day this week teaching. If you meet, okay, he preaches one day, right? Peter, he preaches one day, the day of Pentecost. And from then on, they're meeting daily in the temple. And he's teaching. What we think of as far as revival is concerned is everybody's out there. Everybody's out there, you know, healings and miracles and so, but we're missing the part that Peter only preached one day. Well, what about the lame man? That happened at the temple. They're headed into the temple for the daily teaching services. And then they minister and this guy gets healed and more people get saved. But the goal that day was not, how many people can we get saved today? The goal that day was they're going to the temple for prayer and to do the teaching time. And all of a sudden, by simply being obedient and doing what Jesus said, they, you know, figuratively, you know, lay hands on the lame man. Okay? That guy gets healed, then all of a sudden it turns into what? The revival of the day. Now, the Apostle Paul went to many different places. He established a lot of churches. What we're going to read exemplifies the pattern in his life when he went places. In Ephesians chapter 20, verse 17, and from Miletus, he, the Apostle Paul, sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. In other words, it's like a seminar. A ministry conference for church leaders. Well, they show up and he does a whole lot of teaching, but if you jump down to verse 31, look at this. He's telling them, therefore, watch And remember that by the space of 3 years, I ceased not to warn everyone night and day with tears. What's he mean by that? He went to Ephesus and he ministered. First thing that happens when he gets to Ephesus, he meets believers and he asks them, have you guys received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said, we didn't even know there was a Holy Ghost. And he says, okay, well, teach, minister, lay hands on, they get filled, speak in tongues, and it goes from there. He was there in Ephesus. Now, I don't know how many people ended up getting saved, but for 3 years, he is in Ephesus, and he is holding services, teaching services for the church, for the body of Christ. He's not out every day running to all the street corners and yelling, you got to get saved, and so on. Now, I'm not saying he never witnessed to anybody, but he tells you right here that by the space of 3 years, I warned you night and day. Meaning, I spent time with you teaching. For 3 years, I am teaching you. In other words, he did what Jesus told the apostles to do. You go, you deliver the word, and the people that believe. He didn't say it'd be an outbreak of revival. He just said the people that believe, you baptize them with water. Now, we know they got filled with the Holy Ghost. We know that there was an instruction in that. And then he said, you know, minister to those that are sick and maimed and all this other. And then, you know, teach them. Teach them to observe everything that I have taught you. So here we are. We're believing God for revival, and rightly so. But all too often, it's like we are bypassing all that instruction of God in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. It's like we want to leapfrog all of that and skip being rooted and grounded in love. Skip coming to the knowledge of His will with all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Skip all of these things that He has said and boom, just go right into revival. We're hindering ourselves. We're hurting ourselves by not taking a hard look at Ephesians, what we've read there in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. And there are other passages we could look at, but those really stand out. By not taking a hard look at those and saying, okay, God, since this is what you want, this is what I want for me. I need to get to that place. I need what I'm reading here to be a description of me. And at the same time, I call the Miami Valley saved in Jesus' name. I say the Miami Valley is in revival. Because see, when we do Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, what God is saying He wants for us, when we're doing that, what we're actually doing is getting ourselves prepared for revival. We're getting ourselves to the place of being ready to steward and facilitate revival. We're getting ourselves in the place to be ready to minister to the sick, the maimed, you know, to cast out the devils. We're getting ourselves at the place of being ready to do that teaching that Jesus said to do. In other words, we're getting to the place of being able to follow in the footsteps of the apostles, and revival is going to be a whole lot easier. One of the things that has hindered revival in the past, you know, there can be an outbreak, but spiritual immaturity has hurt it repeatedly. And those who were mature, it's almost like they got shouted down by the ones who were immature. And the people who were immature, they messed it up. This has gone on over and over again. We're so close to the return of Jesus. And revival is happening now throughout the world. People by the thousands are coming in. But you're not going to hear this on the secular news. It's not going to happen. You know, just because we don't hear it on the secular news doesn't mean it isn't happening. It is happening. But we've got to be at that place of being able to fulfill all those commands of Jesus, which includes the teaching part, the discipling part. The Apostle Paul, he stays 3 years in Ephesus ministering to these people, teaching them. And when he would go to these other locations, he would spend time there, maybe a year, maybe a two. You know, it was a different length of time each place that he went. But he didn't just go in and, okay, everybody gets saved and all this, and then boom, he goes to the next city. No, he stayed around for a while. And he did everything he could. You know, Father, who should the leaders be? Help me understand who I should, you know, hand over the stewardship of this church to when I leave. And God would work in people, and people would submit to, you know, these things that we read about in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. And so you had believers in all these different locations who would submit to this. And they would grow. And they would be ready to minister. This is one of the reasons why Paul was so shocked when he gets reports about the churches there in Galatia and then over there in Corinth. You know, he's like, what's wrong with you people? I spent all this time with you. And in some of these places, he went back more than once. Our responsibility is to be ready for revival. To become what we've read there in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. And to continue praying for revival and confessing for revival. But we have to have both. We have to be pressing into both. The one is for our personal development so we can be ready for the influx of people. So we can be ready to minister. I mean, here's a bizarre thought. What if, you know, revival breaks out, just not in this church, but in another church? And you think, well, that's not fair. Well, it's God's kingdom, not ours. But then you get a phone call from somebody you know in that church. And they're wondering if you can come over and help disciple the people who have been saved. Now, I have a hard time really imagining something like that happening, but at the same time, what if it did? What if it did? What would you do? Say, well, why don't you call our pastor? You know, no, it's supposed to be all of us. We're supposed to be ready to give an answer for what we believe. You should be able to go into a room of new converts and give them the basic principles of Christ, the basic principles of salvation, the basic principles of being filled with the Holy Spirit and what praying in tongues will do. You should be able to go in and do that. Now, we're not talking, you know, line upon line, break it all down, the Greek, the Hebrew, and all that. No, we're just talking about the very basic things that all believers should know. Every one of us needs to press into that place. So again, it's not wrong to pray for revival, and it's not wrong to confess for revival, but we can't skip this other part. We can't ignore that and just assume, all right, well, you know, we pray revival in, and then God's going to take care of it. Well, wait a second. No, no. We've got a role to play in this. We're His church. We need to be able to tell people about, you know, being rooted and grounded in His love, about coming to that place of having the knowledge of His will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. We need to be able to disciple people into these things. That is what the apostles did. They weren't running around trying to start revival, but revival happened because they were obedient to the instructions of Jesus. And God went with them. He worked with His word. He confirmed His word. And great things happened. It's the same thing for every one of us. Same thing for this church. Same things for any church that's believing God for revival. Keep praying for it. Keep confessing for it. But press into these things that God has said He wants to see happen in our lives. And then we're going to be ready. We will be His facilitators of revival, fulfilling His instructions. Praise God. Well, go ahead and stand. Now, I know I repeated myself many, many times by saying, it's not wrong to pray for revival. It's not wrong to confess for revival. Because I know how people are. They hear half a sermon with half of one ear. Wake up about every 10 minutes, hear a couple of words, go back to sleep. And then when it's over, start telling everybody, he said we're not supposed to confess for a revival. He said to quit praying for a revival. He did not say that. He said do it, but no, don't neglect the other. Father, I praise you. And I pray for me, for the people here, the people watching, that we would become what you've described in Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. That we would be that kind of mature believer. And then, Father, we would be able to minister in revival to accomplish your goals. Father, I thank you that we're going to see revival here in this region. I thank you, Father, that Satan is defeated and Jesus Christ is Lord over the Miami Valley. I thank you for this. And Father, I give you the praise and the glory for how you're going to use all of us and this church to accomplish your will. You know, Father, as we see it in the Word, we just declare, here we are, use us. So I give you the praise for this. And Father, again, I want to thank you for healing manifesting in our bodies. I thank you, Father, that we are born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and our bodies are healed because by Jesus' stripes we were healed. I praise you for that. Thank you, Father. Father, as we leave tonight, just ask you to watch over us, protect us and our vehicles, that we would arrive home safely. Thank you for a wonderful day. Jesus, we give you the praise for another victory in you. In your name, Jesus, amen. 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 Praise God. Praise God. And I got to tell you what. Praise and worship was really good today. But I had a hard time staying focused, you know. I mean, I couldn't keep my eyes off that worship leader. Glory to God. Whoo, glory. Whoo, glory. And again, I say, whoo, glory. For those of you watching, as my wife, okay? This collective sigh across the internet land, whoo, glory. All right, listen, if you have an offering tonight, go ahead and bring it up. Those of you watching, send in your offerings. We thank you for that. You guys have a blessed remainder of this evening. Oh, and by the way, it's summertime, which is a good time for ice cream. If you've never been down the street and had one of those Jet Freeze ice cream cones, man, you owe it to yourself. Give it a try. I don't get a discount for this, okay? Just but when you do, just say, Pastor Jim from the church down yonder, he sent me in here. And that way when I walk in and say, I'm Pastor Jim, the guy, they're just going to say, so? That'll be $2, please. All right, you guys, have a blessed remainder of the evening, and we will see you again.